Hey guys, today I want to talk about some of the more underrated weapons that came out or were changed with the final shape. I think we all know that the meta is mostly around Still Hunt and that there's a lot of very popular and powerful weapons, stuff like the Call that everybody already kind of knows is super powerful. So I want to talk about some of the things that might have flown under your radar as effective choices, especially with how much they've changed the sandbox in raids by adding surges and reducing our power level in them. So we're going to go ahead and get into some of those details. Let's go ahead and have a look at five of the most underrated weapons that changed or came out in the final shape. So to kick things off, we're going to talk about the Lost Signal. And this is a brand new weapon frame on a brand new weapon with some pretty powerful perks. So I've talked about the Lost Signal quite a bit in some polls on my YouTube channel, as well as in Discord with some people, and I notice a lot of people have either said that they don't like it or they don't even know what it is. So the Lost Signal is the Area Denial Frame Grenade Launcher, and this thing has some very powerful quirks that we're going to talk about here. So just taking a look at the frame, you could see right away that it has a really weird firing pattern. Basically, you shoot the weapon and it does a burst of shots, sort of like a fusion rifle does. It is important to note that this burst of shots can be interrupted, so if you start shooting and immediately sprint, you're going to cancel the weapon firing, and that is going to waste ammo, so you need to bear that in mind. However, it's super easy to avoid doing this, so I haven't had any problems with that. But what really makes this firing mode so powerful is that you can wave it around while it's shooting, and you can place it in super spread out areas. So this is something Witherhorde just isn't capable of, which is why I think it's genuinely better than Witherhorde in the ad clearing department. Basically, if you have two spawn doors, you could literally start off aiming at one, shoot the weapon, and then flick your aim to the other, and you will be covering both of the spawn doors at the same time in one shot. It's faster and it's more ammo efficient. It's worth noting that most of the competition for this weapon is going to come in the form of Witherhorde or Waveframes, so we're basically going to be comparing this weapon to those, because we all know that Witherhorde and Waveframes are pretty good ag clear weapons, and I think this kind of brings the best of both worlds in both of them. The other benefit that this has over Waveframe is that I think it has a much easier time hitting flying targets. While it's definitely not the best weapon for hitting flying targets, it's still capable of damaging them at all. If you shoot a flying target with a Waveframe, it basically just harmlessly bounces off of them doing like 1,000 damage, and then falls on the ground and misses. However, if you direct hit an enemy with this, the pool will land wherever you hit the enemy at, and it will sit there, and it oftentimes will stagger the enemy, which will make them sit in it long enough to die, because it has pretty good damage. Now, just to add on to this, the weapon also gets some insanely powerful perks. I mostly see two angles to be gone with. The first one is running auto-loading holster in the third column, and then mixing it with either demo, reverberation, or vorpal weapon, or even one for all if you do want to do some major clear with the weapon. However, the way I've been running it is using demolitionist mixed with lead for gold in the third column. I'm a warlock main, and I've been playing a ton of prismatic, and when I have devour active, I basically get my entire grenade back every time I shoot this weapon almost, so I've been able to just use demolitionist as a reload perk, and pretty much just have lead for gold as extra benefit, which is super good because this is definitely a double special weapon. That was probably the most long-winded of the weapons. The next ones are going to be quite a bit shorter, they're quite a bit simpler, and they're a little bit easier to explain. So let's go ahead and get into the next one. And this is going to be a bit of a cook. It's a little bit out there, but you just got to hear me out. And this is It Stared Back. Now that's a name you probably don't recognize or have completely forgotten, because it is the sword from the Leviathan Raid. And you may be wondering why I'm mentioning that. And there's one simple reason, and it's pretty much just convenience for those of us that have it. So if you have been paying attention to things, you'll know that regular mode dungeons and raids now have power surges that are rotating with the week. And whenever you get solar surge on sword bosses, it's kind of a pain because Lament just got nerfed, and so its damage is not amazing, especially with Galley Sword only working on legendary swords. And there are better solar swords out there. However, when it comes to the second boss where you're not able to use Surrounded, you're basically looking for a sword with Whirlwind and Relentless, and preferably on an adaptive frame. And this sword does actually check off all three of those boxes. However, because it is using the old masterworking system, it does have two less impact than regular swords. However, you should also check your bolt, because if you have either Abide Thy Return, or the just in case, then you would be wanting to use those god rolls over this, but they're kind of annoying to obtain. And if you guys did play back in year one and you did the Leviathan, you probably just have this sword sitting in your collections. And remember, Bungie did unsunset all of the old sunsetted weapons, so you can pull this out on power level and use it right away. And this is something I'm definitely going to be doing this week against the Herald of Finality, just because it is currently Solar Surge and it's going to be one of the better swords for it. It's also a little bit funny that it's even viable at all. And I went and looked back at a lot of the old sunset weapons that are in collections, and pretty much none of them have perks that can really stand out today. However, ironically enough, swords meta has literally never changed in their entire history in the game. So yeah, the perks on the old sword are still the best perks in the game on swords. And next up, we're going to be talking about a little bit of a glow up story, and that is in the form of the Wild Style. If you guys didn't know, the Wild Style dropped last season from Nightfalls, and it had some of the most absolutely terrible god-awful perks in the entire game. But it was something that we were hyped up for before we knew the perks, because it was going to be the first solar and double frame grenade launcher that we'd had ever, and that's a pretty good archetype to have. However, with the drop of the season, they have actually modified the perks on the old version of the weapon, so there's actually great perks on it now. It gets access to Reconstruction and Bait and Switch. And this is an absolutely insane combination, because the main reason that you would use this weapon is in rotations. This is pretty much the best weapon for doing Izzy swapping with Apex Predator, because it matches surges, and it is a double fireframe grenade launcher, so it is pretty much the best weapon as a third weapon in Izzy swapping, which is still relevant at least in the older bosses. However, it is pretty hard to pull off in the current raid. That being said, if you're somebody who enjoys doing damage rotations, especially Izzy swapping, I highly recommend picking up a Wild Style once it becomes farmable from GMs. The next weapon I want to talk about is the Critical Anomaly. So this is a very unique weapon, and it is brand new, and it is a sniper which has chill clip. So automatically, being a sniper, it basically is the fastest firing chill clip weapon that we have access to right now. And the beautiful thing is that Bungie recently reverted the nerf that they did the chill clip so that it only applies to Riptide. This means that this sniper is able to fire two shots and freeze opponents, and this is also a great perk to have on a sniper specifically, because snipers are often used for the utility anyways. I think that this is mostly going to shine in Grandmaster Strikes, and this is because having a long distance weapon capable of very quickly stunning two types of champions is actually pretty powerful, especially since it's a legendary, it doesn't even take up your exotic slot. This means that you can either just get Radiant, which you can do pretty easily by picking up orbs this season, or just use a barrier weapon, and you very easily have all of your champion stuns covered with a pretty minimal amount of effort. I also want to talk about the funny interaction of using Facet of Command with Chill Clip. I did test it, and yes, this does just give the weapon a bottomless clip. It will just automatically reload constantly until you run out of ammo. And remember that Chill Clip is in the third column, and this weapon does have access to Bait and Switch in the fourth column. So this might even make it a decent DPS option for longer damage phases where you run out of heavy and you just need to start using your special. However, Supremacy has Bait and Switch as well and a pretty good reload perk, and it may end up just being better for damage. Currently, our damage testing table is not fully updated because basically everything has to be retested, so we'll have to see what the numbers look like in the future. And the last weapon I want to talk about is going to be something that flew under our radar actually in Into the Light, however it didn't really have a chance to shine then like it does now. And that is going to be the Other Half. The Other Half is pretty well known as being the best Eager Edge sword, however, it is no longer considered the best Eager Edge sword as we now have access to Slammer with enhanced Eager Edge. That being said, it's still a very powerful sword and it has a lot of great perk combinations, and it's still a very strong Eager Edge sword. The difference between Eager Edge on different sword types is pretty minimal, and so it's not really a big deal, and it also has some advantages over it, so it's still a great sword. However, we're not actually talking about Eager Edge on this weapon. We're going to be talking about the DPS role, because we actually have a boss that calls for swords for the most part, and we need legendary swords so that we can get the yellow sword effect on them. Now, a lot of people have been touting the Falling Guillotine as being the best damage sword for some reason. However, people seem to forget that it is a Vortex Frame, and Vortex Frame swords are just absolutely god-awful for damage. If you didn't know, Vortex Frames require 6 ammo on a heavy attack, which is double the amount that it takes on an adaptive frame, and it does very similar damage. So if you guys didn't know, this weapon had its perks changed into the light, and it was added surrounded back into its perk pool, which is obviously very good for stuff like Crota. However, when it comes to Herald of Finality, it does have access to Whirlwind Blade as well, so you can have the Relentless Whirlwind combo on an Adaptive Frame Sword, and its Void, which is the current best element. However, obviously you want to be matching whatever these surges are for the week. So next time Void Surge comes around and you're doing the second encounter on Salvation's Edge, definitely pull this thing out. You can even put Eager Edge on the third column if you're not worried about an ammo perk, and you can have decent damage and good movement. There's a ton of different combinations, and I would call this probably the most versatile sword in the game, just because it basically has every single relevant perk that you could need on a sword in the current meta. Anyway, that's going to do it for the video. Thank you guys for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one. And if you did still stick around to the end, make sure you guys join my Discord. I have it linked in the description. We have a lot of cool stuff there, including a channel with a bunch of links to build links. So go ahead and check that out. Again, it'll be in the description.